The hijab for me, I was born in Chicago, raised in Dallas. So my parents were also raised here in America. So my background is Pakistani. Just if you don't know what Pakistan is, next to India. So, yeah, I mean, a lot of people just confuse it with India. So different, but very similar. But anyway, so being raised in America, religion wasn't really prominent in my life. It wasn't a huge thing to concentrate on. My family was very just set on, you know, being a good person, and that ultimately is the goal in every, you know, way of life and religion, etc. So nothing was really stressed religiously, and nobody in my family wears a hijab. I actually graduated high school, and my first day at UTA was actually in shorts and a tank top, and it wasn't, it nothing, like, honestly, when people think of hijab, it's, there's a lot of things attached to it. If a girl doesn't wear a hijab, suddenly it's just like, she's not as Muslim as she should be. And then it's like, you know, she probably has, like, so much, you know, that's one side of it. Then it's like, if you wear a hijab, oh, you're very, very holy and all of that. So lots of things go with it in both ends of the spectrum. And whenever I came to UTA and met girls wearing the hijab, Shira was one of the girls I met in the very beginning at the Muslim Student Association. I was like, let me just go to this meeting and see what's up. And all these girls were, like, covered, and I was very, very confused. I was like, why? And I never understood it. But over time, life hits you, and you start realizing you need something more than just abstract concepts to get through life. So I started concentrating a lot more on religion. You know, college hits you really hard and things get difficult. So over time, just, you know, started getting a little closer to religion, started studying up on it. Family wasn't that involved, so it was kind of independent. And just as time progressed, it felt like something I felt like I wanted to do to satisfy myself internally. It was a very, very personal decision. I've only been wearing it for a year. It was actually my one-year hijab-iversary a couple of days ago, so I was very happy about that. I was like, yeah, okay, I made it, 1 year. But it came to the point where I was just exhausted with being seen as, like, people wouldn't know that I was Muslim immediately, and at one point I just wanted them to know. And so a lot of it, for me personally, is about identity. And it's about being able to tell people that, like, look, you see all this crazy stuff on the media, but just hear me out and know that it's not, it's, it's like, respectively, every religion is just so fascinating in its own light, just like Islam is, just like Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, etc.
So. My story is a little, like, simpler, because, like, I was already raised in a family that was, like, heavily wearing the scarf, and I was also raised in a Muslim school, so the uniform was wearing the scarf, so I wasn't, like, I didn't have to go through the social pressures of high school and middle school where people, like, picked on you, like, your appearance, so, but I did, like, have to go through the whole challenge of knowing why I'm wearing it, because I wore it to school, but I took it off after school, but when I hit, like, high school, it was when I realized, like, the whole reason why I was wearing the scarf, and from then on is, like, when I, like, fully wore the scarf, even after school hours, and then, like, when I went to college, I was like, well, a lot of people were like, oh, you're a Muslim, so, like, you guys can't really do that much, because Muslim girls are like, oh, you have to do only, like, certain things, but I was like, no, I'm gonna do engineering, like, I'm gonna try to get this job and be there, and, like, there's not a lot of women's in engineering already, so the being, like, a Muslim woman is, like, something even more prominent, so that's the story. The purpose is modesty. It's not just to cover the hair. Covering the hair is just one of the aspects of modesty. It's also, like, covering your arms and wearing, like, longer pants, or, like, even more conservative is wearing, like, the whole long skirt. But my idea of a hijab is just looking modest and your behavior, and not being, like, how would I say it? Like, your behavior is, like, you have to, like, when you wear the scarf, there's a certain way you should behave. It's, like, you should be, like, a nice, gentle person. You can't be, like, all exuberant and stuff, because the scarf does represent Islam. But in a way, you still have a way of expressing yourself by, like, having your scarf, like, your fashion statement and your whatever major you are. So it's like, there's a balance between a lifestyle with the hijab and, like, the Islamic, like, holy meaning of the scarf.
So,
So, like they were saying, so it's a sign of modesty, and like the Prophet Muhammad and like religious background women are supposed to, they're held on a pedestal. So you get that idea that women are oppressed, blah blah blah, all this. But in our religion, in our culture, women are supposed to be like highly respected and held to a, like on a pedestal, like I said. So with the hijab, I feel like is, like they said, you have to act a different way. You have to, you represent, especially in a culture where, in America, where most people are, don't wear it, most people aren't Muslim, you're representing a culture that's misunderstood, that's misrepresented, that's a minority. So I feel like me putting the scarf on isn't enough. Like, I need to change the way I act. I need to, like, there are a lot of things I do that I can't do anymore. Just, I cannot represent Islam that way. So I feel like as a person, I'm not ready to do that. I'm not ready to make those commitments, if that makes sense. So I feel, like they said, you have to, like, you can't wear tight clothing. It's just like you, I feel like if I was to put it on, it would just be a fashion statement at my point. And when I want to put it on, I want to put it on for the right reasons. I've never been pressured in my life to put it on or anything like that. It's a decision that I want to make, and I feel like that I'm not ready to make it. If that makes sense.
Some questions here.
Do your mothers wear them also, or?
Yeah, most of my family wears it. Mm-hmm. Like, most of the older women in my family wear it. My mother wears one, her mom wore one, so, and she's never pressured me into wearing it. It's just a decision that I can make, and that's the way it's supposed to be.
So can I ask you, without being in any way offensive, are you like the rebel in the family?
No, not at all. No, there's four girls in my family and a little boy, and none of us, we haven't worn it yet. So,
and has your family been really supportive of that?
Yeah, I mean, they're, obviously there's that from that culture, hey, you should, like that, yeah. Hey, you should put on, you should wear it, you should think about it, but they're definitely, there's no, like, we are not talking to you. It's just, yeah, just because you don't wear them, one, doesn't make you any less of a Muslim. It's just one aspect of my life that I haven't decided to approach yet, if that makes sense, so.
It definitely took some time to finally be comfortable with the idea of being Muslim, being comfortable with Islamic law and Islamic ideologies. So once I felt that I was comfortable enough to that point where if somebody was to ask me a question regarding Islam, I wouldn't be like shaky or hesitant. I would confidently be like, I love this religion and I'm willing to answer this for you. It was definitely took, I mean, nobody in my family wears it. My mom doesn't wear it. We're quite the opposite of very modest, my whole family is, and nothing's wrong with that. My problem was actually, are you sure you want to wear it? Like, do you really want to do that? Like, and all family gatherings, it's like, first of all, I'm almost 6 feet tall, so it's like, everyone? Random scarf, and then everybody else. So, yeah, it's a lot about identity for me, personally. For me, it's a lot about identity.
Yeah, well, from that, it's like some people are like, they're not ready for the commitment, because once you wear the scarf, there is like a certain way, like you behave, like you're nice and poised and stuff. But like some people are like just not ready for that commitment, like she was saying. Like some people have a different journey level to the hijab. It's like even right now we're both still practicing this.
Still scarf. Trying to figure.
We still
it
have
out.
Challenges with the scarf
every single day.
So I mean, some people who wear it after they get married, it's like, well, they feel like they don't need to, I guess. I don't know, express themselves as much anymore. I don't know, because, yeah.
A lot of times it does have a lot of influence from your significant other, mm-hmm. which is absolutely not how it should be, which is actually pretty concerning when you're, honestly, it's such a personal decision. It has nothing to do with anyone except yourself. And if you don't wake up in the morning and be like, I want to put this on or I don't want to wear it, it's just so personal. And it makes me sad when people assume that anyone else has a say in you and your hijab or you and whatever level of modesty you wish to convey. People feel empowered in different ways. Mm-hmm. Like Shahira said, a lot of it is about where you are in your journey. I personally do admire those women who can feel comfortable mm-hmm. being in an abaya. Abaya is the long black dress. And where I admire that so much. That's not where I am, personally. I feel the need to express myself in different ways. Like, I do wear a full face of makeup. I do, like, you can see some of my hair peeking through. a lot of my stuff is very bright and colorful, and that's just because that's why I stand Islamically. I feel like when somebody sees me, I want to be like, hi, I'm Muslim. Like, you know, it's I'm normal, but I'm still Muslim, you know? And it's just, and again, that has, like, it's a lot about character, too. And if
I just feel like people assume that modesty from the opposite gender also means, like, oh, being, like, rude to the opposite gender. But it basically just means creating a distance and just being very cautious with what you say and how you act, as opposed to, I can't talk to you, you're a guy.
Yeah. Like, the whole purpose, I mean, is so that a female isn't treated like you're not an object. You have wisdom, you have intelligence. So when a man approaches you or a man sees you, he's not just looking at the way you're dressed. He's not just looking at you in a swimsuit. He sees beyond that. So, like, I'm not wearing a scarf on my head, but I do dress modestly, and I don't. So I'm just not at the level of wearing the hijab yet. So, like they said, I'm still on that journey. I'm dressed modestly. I don't wear shorts. I don't wear tank tops, just because I don't want a man to only see me for my body, if that makes sense. So that's the whole purpose of Islam. So, like, adultery, just like in any religion, is a sin. Relationships before marriage is a sin, all of that. So Islam tries to, like, avoid those things and, like, get rid of the temptation, I guess. So that's the whole purpose, is to just kind of, modesty is the entire purpose.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, the word hijab has endless meanings. The hijab is not only the head covering. A lot of people do translate it into as, like, the specifically the head covering. Hijab is the way you act. Mm-hmm. It's your, like, the essence you portray to other people. It's, like, I mean, there could be a woman walking around, like, not dressed modestly at all, but her character just is so modest. The way she treats people is so kindly, and that speaks so much more than just your appearance. And honestly, like, your physical appearance only goes so far, and there's just so many definitions of the word hijab, not just this, like, by any means. So.
Is it also called a burqa?
The burqa is the whole thing.
I mean, burqa is the whole thing. Yeah, niqab is this thing.
The niqab is when you have just your eyes showing.
And yeah. that's okay. Strictly cultural.
Yeah, right? It's very cultural.
It's not. Yeah. Our religion has never required it. It's strictly, like, I mean, women from Saudi Arabia wear that. It's just part of the culture. So a lot of people confuse that with religion.
Culture confuses
a lot. But there is, like, people who are at that level who are strictly wearing it because they believe in it, not just because of the culture, mm-hmm. not the social pressures of, like, where they're from. But there are some people who are at that level where they're, like, totally confident with themselves that they wear that just with the eyes showing, and, like, they just want to show their body to their husbands.
Oh, I know.
What's that term again?
Niqab. I know a niqabi, and she goes to UTA, and her care, oh my gosh, that girl is on fire. Like, the way she just, you don't need to see any, like, an inch of her just to see her. Like, you know, her character, she just, and I hope she sees this, I love you, but, like, she's so amazing, and she's, like, she's an activist, and she, like, fights for human rights, and she's, like, a humanitarian, and nobody even needs to know what she looks like, and her character just says it all for her. It's pretty awesome. I admire that. I'm like, I don't know how you do it, but I... Wow. The three Abrahamic religions are... You could put them side to side, and mm-hmm. you'll find more similarities than differences. Mm-hmm. Hands down, you will find more similarities than differences. I went to a Bible study class this entire summer almost, and I was just like, yeah, we do that too. Like, awesome. And we compared New Testament, Old Testament, and the Quran all next to each other, and I'm just like, we just concentrate so much on how different we are, and I'm like, we're all, like, the same people.
Yeah, so Muslims acknowledge the Bible and Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. We love Jesus.
Yeah.
Where does it break off?
It's, the break off is, like, the last prophet that we follow. Like, we back in the day when it was Moses' time, they were basically Muslims. In our religion, we consider them Muslims, so they died as a Muslim to us too. And then Isa came along,
which is Jesus
in
Islam.
And then basically the people of Moses were supposed to follow Isa, but they stopped. They didn't follow. They rejected him, and then two religions started forming. And then from there, then Muhammad came, and he was supposed to be the next prophet that everyone was supposed to follow, but they didn't reject, they rejected him, so then three different, like, branches.
Ideologies and branches.
Yeah, and so the break-off is the following of the last prophet, and with every prophet, there's always some, like, new,
revelations, I guess?
Yeah, revelations you could call it that come with the prophet. So, like, some religions are missing, like, what we have. Like, for us, we consider ours to be the last prophet, so we have, like, the most complete revelations.
Yeah. But you do acknowledge Jesus was
a prior prophet.
Oh, yes. They are.
Jesus, Noah, Moses, all of them.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to the mosque to pray, so that's like the church of Islam, basically. So you're required to like be fully covered just out of modesty and out of respect when you go to pray to God. Like that's God's house, basically. So I am fully covered when I go there. I travel. I go to Jordan. Oh, I have a lot of family in Jordan, and I just like I kind of. It's not just because it's required. A lot of people don't wear it over there. I just like feel just kind of try it out for fun, just to like get in my comfort zone, because it's all like. A journey. My parents were just like, hey, you should try it out here and there just to see what it feels like or whatever. So when I go to Jordan, I feel like there's not that, like a lot of people wear it there, so it's more comfortable and more, it's not as, I'm not like an outcast kind of or whatever. So I wear it sometimes over there, but that's not because it's required or anything. So
do you face any stigma from outsiders wearing it?
I work at the airport. I work for Emirates Airlines, and yes, every day there's something or the other. It's people talk to you slowly, thinking you can't speak English. So I didn't learn any other language until I was 5, so I'm just like you. But every day it's like it's one thing or the other, and honestly, through time you just learn to understand that, you know, people are uncomfortable with what they're not familiar with. I could be the first Muslim they're ever meeting, ever. And so it's just, in a way, an honor for me, because I'm like, you know, like, I want to share a story real quick. It's really fast. It's not long. I was in class, in English class, and right after I just went to the bathroom to fix my scarf, and a very, very, you know, a very strong Christian, she's Pentecostal, I believe, she follows me to the bathroom, and she's just staring at me, and she's like, can I see you while you're fixing your hijab? I'm like, yeah, you know, girls can see each other, like, without hijab. We have all-girl parties where we, like, dress up and do our hair and stuff, but those are really fun. But, like, she's just staring at me, and she's like, I've never met a Muslim before, and I just want to talk to you. And I'm like, let's go get coffee. And we just sat, talked for 5 hours, and it's just, people are uncomfortable with what they don't know, so... I understand that. It's okay. Like, just, that's why we're here.
Yeah. It's not a hate. That's not where it's stemming from. It's the, I don't know. Mm-hmm. What I'm hearing is just in the media. I've never met these types of people. So that's where it stems from. So.
Yeah, we always get the question, like, isn't it hot wearing it? Well, we've worn it for, like, how long? We're so used to the heat.
We need bathroom breaks to go and just, like, a ventilate or something.
I mean, my mom wears one, so when I was younger, like, especially, like, after 9/11, basically, so a few years after that, so anytime I go to Walmart, you'd get stares, you'd get looks, but you just kind of wipe it off.
Yeah. Like, I mean, just the way... Not all Christians are a part of the Westboro Baptist Church. Not all white people are in the Ku Klux Klan. The same way, not all Muslims are with Al-Qaeda, et cetera. So it's just...
Yeah, exactly.
I don't even know what that is. Like, it's just pathetic people that are... There's extremists in every part of everything. Not even religion, just cultures and ideologies. Like, extremists everywhere. And, like, it just sucks because they have to make the name for everyone else really bad.
But, like, over here, it's like... It's America. It's like we're all equal. We have our own freedom. So.
You walk around with, like, wearing all your religious stuff, and it's such a blessing to be able to do that here. It's awesome. Like, walking out and just, aside from all the discrimination and stuff, it's honestly really a great feeling to be able to walk out dressed how you want to dress. And, of course, just like there are extremists in every religion, there are extremists in every, like, individual person's ideology, and there are men out there, just like there are men in Christianity and Judaism, etc., that just like, oh, I want you to do this and this and this, but it's like, what right does a man have to say how I dress? And
so that whole, like, women not driving in Saudi Arabia, that's also
cultural.
That's not, a lot of what you see, it's being like confused with culture. So in our religion, women are literally like the princesses. So I mean, I just, like they were talking about earlier, like the girl that you, the wears the head, like Nicole. It takes so much confidence, not because she's oppressed, it's because she wants to wear it and she has enough confidence to wear it. I don't have enough confidence to wear that. I don't have enough confidence to wear a hijab. It's not oppressive, it's actually, it's like freeing. Like it builds your self-esteem, it builds your confidence.
It's liberating.
Liberating. That's
so
the
many
word.
Levels.
So that whole aspect just gets confused. And you're focusing, the thing, I feel like the media and the like society focuses on the negative aspects of Islam. Like you're never looking at a, like, do they ever have a documentary about like
how liberating the hijab is. No, they don't. It's all about how negative and how oppressive it is. And so you're just seeing that aspect of it. Yeah. Does that make sense?
There are different, there are like different Islamic countries, like the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, which I'm most familiar with, obviously, because I'm of Pakistani descent. When people, I feel like whenever I went over there, it was, for, I'm the only one of my cousins that wears it. Even when they live over there, they don't wear it. And it's just, they, I feel like a lot of it comes from being rebellious. Like, I live in an Islamic country, so I shouldn't have to, like, it's a lot about your surroundings. And the thing that messes everything up is the mixture of culture and religion. That is the biggest thing that throws everyone off. And the best way to stay away from that ignorance is to go back to, like, the purest word that you can, like, that trace it down to. Like, whenever I want to find out something about Christianity, I don't look at Westboro, I look at the Bible. I'm like, okay, let me figure out, like, what verses talk about this, and then I understand it better. So I can understand my peers better and understand, like, Hinduism, you go back to the Gita, etc. And it's just, ignorance comes from just seeing what's on the surface, and people give it such a bad name. It's just, ah.
Yeah. Not in my, I've never had a problem once, and I even grew up like Weatherford, pretty small redneck town, like I never had a problem with anything. Yeah, like, to be honest, yeah, even when my last name's like Abdul Jalil, like, totally sounds Muslim, so I've never had a problem. Have y'all?
No,
I haven't. No, had
a, we're American, so I mean, we feel like we've had the same rights as everybody else, and there's that stereotype, there's that, like, kind of looking down upon that person.
But I think, like,
sometimes
nowadays it's better, like, because there's a lot more youth people who are, like, getting
standing out,
who are getting, like, more knowledge about, like, all religions, and they're, like, more open-minded than the people who are, like, older and conservative and, like, have their own, like, shell of what they believe in, mm-hmm, or what they know.
Going to the beach gets complicated.
Yeah.
It gets complicated, I'm not gonna lie, but you figure it out.
Yeah.
Yes.
So. Why is that?
Well, I figured it out finally. So you, like, there's, like, scuba tights. So you get those so you don't, like, walk around like a saggy dog. And then you have, like, special underpieces that you can wear. So all your hair is intact. You can do, like, a cute scarf and throw it on. There's Islamic swimwear.
Yeah.
I just ordered one, like, for next summer. I'm so excited. They had a sale, so I was like, ah, but, yeah.
No, I mean, like, it's just a sign of modesty. Like, if you want to wear it, like, if you look at the Virgin Mary, a lot of queens from Europe, they covered their hair, they covered their body. It was just a sign of modesty. It didn't affiliate with religion. It was, so it's the same thing. Like, if you, why are we, when we look at a picture of a Muslim woman in a scarf, a terrorist, but you're looking at a picture of Virgin Mary or a queen, the Queen of England or somebody like that, that's fully covered.
Graceful.
Hair, or nuns, like, nuns are fully covered, they cover
completely
everything, and we just look at them, wow, they're so devout, they're not oppressed, blah, 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 but when you're looking at a Muslim woman, why is she wearing that, she's so depressed, her parents made her do that, her husband made her do that, what's the difference between that and a nun, or so, that kind of, I totally went off topic of what you were saying.
I'm really glad
sorry,
you
I just
said
thought
that.
Of that, sorry.
I have this habit where when I see a woman wearing a hijab, I'll automatically say, assalamu alaikum. You know, that's like the greeting in Islam. That was my bad, because I was at the mall, and I did see a woman, like a white woman, wearing a hijab. And I was like, oh, assalamu alaikum. And she's like, and I was kind of confused. We ended up going to three different stores, like, I mean, three similar stores. Like, we just kept walking through. You know how you just kind of follow each other around at the mall? But, no, I wasn't talking to her. But I finally, like, we were at Express, I think, and she was standing there, and then I was just like, so I'm like, how are you? How's your day going? You know, just like generally, like talking to her, and then she's like, oh, I get that a lot. And then she started talking to me. It's I've met like only two people that like aren't Muslim and wear the hijab, but at the end of the day, it's all about, like she said, modesty. And she was just talking about how it's like, her name was Mary. She was just talking about how I feel comfortable. You know, I just feel comfortable. Everything's covered. I just feel really like secure. And I'm like, are you from like here? You know. And she spent some time overseas in Spain and came here and stuff. And then, but it wasn't anything to do with religion, just because she was comfortable. So I'm glad you brought that up.
I was born in Fort Worth, Texas. I'm an American, like 100%, like above anything, I feel like. So my patriotism hasn't been affected at all by like that. I'm more proud to be an American. Like, like they say, America's like the melting pot. I feel like it's more like a salad bowl kind of. Yeah, so I feel like I just represent one of the minorities of America, and I'm proud to represent that. And when I go to Jordan, when I go to other countries or whatever, I'm like, yeah, I'm an American. Like, so I feel like that hasn't affected. I'm just a minority. So,
Same, like, were you born in Pakistan?
No, he was born in Chicago.
See, I was born in Malaysia, but I was raised here. Like, I was raised here. I moved here when I was, like, 3. So I was pretty much American. So I consider myself American, even though I don't have, like, U.S. citizenship. I have, like, the green card permanent resident, and it says Malaysia. I'm just like, I don't know. I'm American. I'm
like, you know more America than Malaysia.
Yeah.
With me, it's like, whenever people ask me, what are you? It's usually Pakistani-American, because I have no right to say that I'm Pakistani, because I'm not a Pakistani citizen. I can't say I'm Pakistani. It's not about, like, I'm American. It's like, I'm not Pakistani. I'm American. Yeah. So it's, I mean, my parents are from Pakistan. They're like, no, but, like, you're basically Pakistani. It's like, no, I'm not. I'm American, but the culture is Pakistani.
Yeah, they realize that when they hear us speak, we're, like, fluently speaking.
Yeah,
English.
I know.
We're
and they're just like, but you don't even have that weird, like oh, no, it's
from. Do people mistake Islam as a country or something?
Oh, like, for sure. As a language, do you speak Islam?
Are you from Islam?
Yeah.
Are you from Islam?
That's huge.
With the hijab, all the time I get, like, are you Arab? Because they think Islam is only Arab. And I'm like,
that's
I'm
another
not
huge
Arab. Mistake. I'm actually, like, Asian, so.
I got pulled over the other day, and I drive really fast. Sorry, Mom. But I got pulled over the other day, and on the ticket, he handed it to me, and it said Middle Eastern. And I'm like, I'm not Middle Eastern. And I'm like, at least ask me. It takes 2 seconds. Like, he said Middle Eastern. I'm like, I'm not even in, like,
not
an ounce
close.
Of me is Middle Eastern.
Yeah. And we celebrate 4th of July. Like,
yeah, 4th of July.
Illegally blow up fireworks, like, all of that. Yeah. Yeah. Fulfilling my stereotype, yeah.
With the religion?
It's taught me a lot of patience ever since I started wearing hijab. Before hijab, I was just any, like, people would think I was Hispanic or something. You know, usually the Indian girl, the tall Indian girl, that's usually what I was. And so, like, after hijab, it was, like, the tall Muslim girl. And then it became, I don't know, usually in the beginning, I would just get frustrated. Like, I would just be like, okay, it's not a big deal. It's just the cloth on my head. Chill out. But then over time, I was like, okay, no, my actions and stuff are what's going to change their perception
opinion, yeah.
of Islam. So if I'm, like, not holding a door for somebody, or if I'm just, like, in a bad mood and it shows all over my face, I do have to suck it up. And I do have to be like, okay, no, you know, whatever. People are going to see me. And I don't want them to be like, Muslims are mean. So it's like, it's you do have to be cautious of everything
you
do.
You do.
Like,
that's one thing,
very
like,
cautious.
I feel like I'm not ready for that. Yeah. But I feel like when you meet somebody like that, you have to find out if they're just, like, really curious and they don't know, or if they just are a hater.
Or if,
like,
they want to challenge you.
So you have to approach them, like, differently.
Some people want to challenge you.
But you don't want to, like, start debating.
No, you just want to,
I just usually just say, God bless you, have a great day.
Yeah.
I'm so tired.
Yeah. And if I'm trying to explain something to them, if I do end up getting a conversation, I'm trying to, like, focus on the similarities. Like, hey, this is what we have in common with you. So I feel like that kind of, that takes on that argument.
Empathy
or it's not really an argument.
Empathy.
Yeah. What?
Empathy versus everything else. Just like, this is how we're alike.
Yeah, this is, I'm just like you, so.
Mm-hmm. I actually wanted that. That's why I'm a big reason why I started hijab. I want, as soon as you look at me, I want you to be like, that's a Muslim girl.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, learn about me and learn that I'm also a poet. I'm also this. But also there's so many other characteristics that follow. But the first thing that's the most important to me is my identity as a Muslim woman. That's what I want you to see. And then whatever else comes. So it's a choice that I made personally. That's for me, like, that's my mindset.